it's wonderful to be playing here. Tonight's program, I always like to say I'm being lazy, I'm only playing two pieces. But of course, these two pieces are two of the most beloved and respected masterpieces of the 19th century, the Schumann Fantasie and the Liszt Sonata in B minor. There are many connections between these two pieces and somewhat of a similarity as well. On a very superficial level, both pieces begin with a G. Begin with this note. Also, both pieces end softly. And the Schumann Fantasie ends piano, the Liszt Sonata ends triple key. And I think this is quite significant because if you compose a piece that's 30 minutes long and you make the pianist work his or her tail off, the pianist wants this big, grand finale so that she or he could stand up and receive all the great applause. But that doesn't really happen when the piece is very soft. And it comes to show that these two composers are more interested in the depth of their musical ideas rather than flashiness and virtuosity. The two pieces were dedicated to each other. Schumann dedicated his Fantasie to Liszt when it was published in 1839, and Liszt returned the favor several years later in 1853 when he composed the Sonata. What a thank you gift, right? Today we just give each other chocolates or thank you cards, but they give each other the Sonata in B minor and the Fantasie in C major. And both works are somewhat of a reinvention of the classical sonata. They take this very old-fashioned, this classic respected form of this Beethovenian piano sonata, and they create a completely different kind of a romantic sonata type piece. The Schumann Fantasie was composed first, and again, it was composed, he started composing it in around 1836, and this was particularly a very difficult period for Schumann. He was madly in love with the virtuoso pianist Clara Wieck, and who was also his piano teacher's daughter. You can kind of see where the problem is already, right? And her father, Friedrich Wieck, was violently opposed to this marriage, or this union, and he's forcefully separated the two and made Clara go on concert tours, and they were not allowed to write to each other and so forth. And so Schumann was in complete anguish, and he poured out his heart in composing many, many piano pieces, and this Fantasie is one of the products. He composed what is to become the first movement, and he wrote to Clara, "I've composed this Fantasie, and it is the most passionate piece I've ever written, a deep lament for you." And indeed, this opening of this Fantasie is nothing like this has ever been composed. Listen to this accompaniment, it's oceanic. Work by Beethoven. very perfect for Schumann to include this melody, Beethoven's melody, because of course he was raising money for the Beethoven monument. But also, the emotional dedicatee of this piece is Clara, who is Schumann's own distant beloved. Now the second movement is a very lively march. But the big surprise is the third movement. Now, traditionally, the final movement of a multi-movement piece is virtuosic and flashy, once again, so that the pianist could get up and receive his or her applause. But instead, Schumann provides a slow movement at the very end, and it is like a benediction.
Thank you.
form, specifically of the sonata form. It is all the traditional characteristics of a multi-movement piano sonata. It has a slow introduction. There's a slow introduction, and then it has a very lively first movement. It has a traditional slow movement. It has a kind of an elfin third movement, a scherzando movement. And it has a kind of a virtuosic, lively final movement, which happens to be the same melody as the first. Now, what is revolutionary about it is that Liszt does not separate these movements. He squishes it all together and creates one massive 30-minute piece. And so there are no breaks in between these so-called movements. An incredible thing is that Liszt only uses 5 motives for the entire duration of the 30 minutes. And so if you actually go through every single measure of this piece, all the melodies, all the motives will be rooted from one of the 5. The first 3 motives are presented right on the first page as if they're characters in a play. A very recognizable, mysterious descending scale. And then a very defiant motive, kind of like the hero of the novel. Schumann Fantasie with a quote by Clara, but I'll do the same with the Liszt Sonata because the Sonata was dedicated to Schumann. And it actually, there is a diary entry by Clara on her receiving the Sonata, and she writes, "Remember Schumann, when she received the Schumann Fantasie, she said, oh, I'm still half ill with rapture. And for the Sonata, she said, today Liszt Sonata arrived. There's no clear ideas anywhere. It's a mess. And now I have to thank him for it. And if that's not enough," she concludes once again, "it really is too terrible." And so clearly for many, many years, many decades in fact, musicians, pianists, even a great pianist like Clara Schumann, did not fully understand this B minor sonata. It was too complicated. It was too difficult. And fortunately, today it has really risen in status as one of truly the greatest works for piano ever.